Hey, Hall and Oates.
Yeah. Love this band. It's a great song. It's a real chill down song. We're in a mask of
false bravado. Yeah, it's subtle. It's real soothing. It's
real smooth, man.
It's kind of like a love song, but it's smooth. I wonder what they're talking about, you know?
You gotta listen to the lyrics.
I'm going to. I wish to God that you were here. Baby, come back. Any kind of fool could see there was something. Literally a love song, huh?
Yeah. Kind of correlates with what we're talking about today.
It does give you that feeling. Let's hear a couple more lines. It's pretty amazing. Kind of gives me the impression of like the love affair between Marvel Studios and Sony that just went awry.
This has been an insane week
for
comic fans. Fans of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, fans of Spider-Man.
Crazy. Yeah, they're creating all these new hashtags. They're forming parties. I'm thinking there's going to be an assault on the precinct soon.
This is going to be like the Area 51 raid. They're going to do that. So, let's unpack what we're talking about today.
All right. Well,
so
go for it.
So today's topic is about if you don't know, oh my God, it was all over social media. It was all over the internet. The lend-lease deal that Marvel Studios had with Sony Studios is now done. They could not come to an agreement. And now Spider-Man is no longer, at this current moment, part of the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Yeah.
That's crazy, by the way.
Yeah, just digest that if you're a fan, what Julian just said there. It's almost hard to believe that this could have ever even happened, right?
Yes.
So something is definitely not right. I mean, Marvel's got a lot to lose, so how could this have ever gotten to this point? Could it have something to do with the fact that they decided they would be happy with 5% of the take on the last couple films to make Sony feel kind of happy, kind of like butter in your bread a little bit?
And they thought on the back end that they're going to recoup more. So when they went to renegotiate, like, Sony wasn't having it. And I'm gonna throw this out there. I'm a little bit happy that Sony did not budge. So first fact, a week prior to all this, you know, Spider-Man, Marvel, Sony business, I read an article that said that Sony was in a pinch a few years ago and they signed over their rights, the 100% complete rights of all the merchandising for Spider-Man. Let me say that again.
In this deal.
Sony signed over 100% of the merchandising rights for Spider-Man. People, that is huge.
It might be worth more than what the amount of money that Sony's receiving from Marvel
Absolutely.
Studios.
Absolutely. 100%.
Without a doubt.
100%. The merchandising, toothbrushes, blankets, toys, covers, blankets, backpacks, watches, anything that you can
Action
think
figures,
of.
Action figures, statues, everything from top to bottom.
Posters, all of that. Like, that's a huge deal. So Marvel was only getting 5%, and it, you know, and Sony did get Kevin Feige, and you know, and Kevin Feige is like a savant when it comes to, you know, producing these movies. He's a real comic
book
geek.
Sure, sure. He's good at that, but he doesn't run the business. He's not the lawyer.
He doesn't do that stuff. So for those who don't know, this is not Kevin Feige's decision.
Correct.
This is definitely the higher ups, you know, the people cutting the checks at Disney, you know, who pretty much interrupted, you know, the story. So this is nothing to do with the story. This
the
is all business.
Yeah. Yeah, like, you know, and I'm surprised, like, when everybody and their brother-in-law was you know, going through the information that they were just provided, and they all started releasing their press stories and everything, and everybody was writing articles and what was going on. The funny thing about it all is nobody brought up what you just said, which I only caught up on it like Friday last week. Or it might have been late Thursday, and it did not factor in any of the conversations. That's actually a major part of the actual deal itself.
That is immensely right. Part of the deal itself.
So that 5% is really not as bad as Marvel's being made. Like they everybody believes that Marvel's really being treated unfairly. No, they're really not. Sony made a great olive leaf branch to them.
Yeah,
they said, look it, man, we're going to give you something that's worth probably $10 billion down the line.
Yes.
And all you got to do is just work with us a little bit.
Yes.
That's the trade-off.
Yeah, and it's not that hard.
It's not that hard to do.
I don't understand it.
Well, it's like two big bullies. Instead of a bully and a small kid getting in a scrum and the small kid's going to get his ass whooped.
Yeah.
It's two bullies, $2 billion corporation bullies that are fighting. And,
yes.
You know, and now they all feel sad, like the Hall & Oates song saying, baby, come back.
Yeah.
It ain't that easy, dudes.
And who suffers? We suffer.
You,
the
me,
fans.
The fans, and everybody.
Like, you know.
Especially after everything they did with Spider-Man to how he got integrated into the whole MCU. I mean, you're really Marvel. You got a lot more to lose than Sony. So you're now they're trying to play extra hardball.
Yeah.
You know, they're playing softball with a hardball. That's dangerous.
I like that. That's clever.
It's nuts.
So when you think about it, Spider-Man is without a doubt the biggest Marvel property. Hands down.
Oh, without
a
doubt.
The character. Oh, you know, over Captain America. And most people don't know that Iron Man, who's beloved, you know, which was played by Robert Downey Jr. You know, if you don't know that, you know, what planet have you been living on? Was a, you know, a B-list character. He wasn't the top tier of Marvel, you know?
No, he was around the level of Daredevil, Submariner, and all those guys. And even Thor a little bit.
Yeah.
You know, and, but, you know, Downey made the character much more popular than he was.
Spider-Man was royalty.
He always has been. And Hulk had some royalty, too, and so did Cap. But Spider-Man was probably the pillar of the Trinity. You know, over at DC, they called the Trinity Batman, Superman, and Wonder Woman.
Yes.
I mean, the Warner Brothers or AT&T probably put Superman first and Batman and Wonder Woman on the side. But Batman clearly outsells and outperforms the Superman character. Batman's the top of the Trinity. And for Marvel, it would be Spider-Man the top of their Trinity.
Yeah.
And, you know, the thing about it is, like, they set him up to be, and we're talking about Spider-Man now, they set Spider-Man up to more or less replace the Stark character. You know, they became good buddies in the last couple of films.
Yeah.
Spider-Man's a smart kid. He's a techie. He's going to get the tech from Stark Studios, from Stark Industries, clearly.
Giddy optimism.
That's a great line. Is that actually a Stark line?
Yeah, that's from Endgame.
Oh, I love that line. Yeah, great line.
That's when Stark had just figured out time travel and he was talking to Cap.
Oh, yeah, now I remember it.
Yeah, but getting back to what we're talking about. So, Spider-Man is pretty much in his two solo movies has had to depend on Tony Stark. So what the guy at Screen Rant was saying is that now we may get a more definitive Spider-Man. Because a lot of people have a problem with the suit.
It'd be the mechanical version, that one.
No, not even the Iron Spider-Man suit.
Oh, I have like a problem with that more than anything.
But the regular suit, because he's still got all the tech. He's got, you know, the suit's got, you know,
He can phase into the AI in the suit.
The suit's got the AI and
it's kind of wonky.
Yeah, and the Spider-Man traditionalists are saying, like, no, give him his regular suit, his web shooters, and let him go. So it may not be a bad thing that Spider-Man is going to be separated a little bit from the MCU. As far as long-term story goes, I feel like Marvel's going to suffer the most.
Without a doubt, because every option that I'm possibly thinking of and what they were trying to do, I just can't even begin to imagine how they're going to get around it. I mean, a lot of these things are planned out like maps. They got all these little, you know, like a war. Everything moves in a certain way, and this falls into place, and next thing takes over from that thing. They got to retool and make a whole new road turn. They got to make a giant U-turn in the middle of an 8-lane throughway.
Yeah.
It's complicated.
And I feel like they definitely had Spider-Man already integrated into what they wanted to do. I feel like they definitely had a plan B if they weren't going to be able to use the character.
I don't think they had a plan B because they did not think Sony was going to do this.
Ooh.
And I heard, you know, as soon as that news came and all the articles coming out, like the Screen Rant ones and all the other ones, there was talk of things like Sony needed something as a really good pillar stone for their whole Spider-Man universe. And they obviously did not have Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Right? So for them, they're thinking like, look, we gave up a lot. We got a lot of money from them. They want you know, more than we can afford to give. That's even fair. What's the best way to solidify the whole line? You have Spider-Man face off against Venom.
That
in a Tom Hardy movie.
That would be tough. And both actors have already expressed that they want to work with each other.
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously they're being professionals. It doesn't matter who's paying them, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I was curious if Tom's. Not Tom Hardy, but Holland's contract.
They're both Tom.
I know, right? I like them both a lot, but I love Tom Hardy a lot. He's just dynamic as a crazy.
Hardy's tough.
He's really tough.
His movies are good, too.
Yeah, there's not many bad ones, man. But anyway, I was just curious if how that contract was signed. And nobody's brought this up. Sometimes I like to think between the lines like you do also. Is it possible that, that Tom Holland has a contract with Marvel Studios to play any role or roles that they want. Let's just say I'm hypothetically, I'm not even mentioning the fact that it's Spider-Man. I mean, if they take Spider-Man back, Tom Holland, does he necessarily have to go? Think about that.
No, no, no. I believe that Tom Holland is contracted to work for Sony.
No, but, I don't. I don't know. How do you know this? You're guessing.
I am guessing. It is like I am. Guessing.
I don't know how those contracts work, but you know, he could be part of the deal. You know, might just go with the deal.
But are you saying that he would play a different character?
No, no. He just doesn't have to go to Sony. Marvel's going to say no.
No, 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 no.
He has a contract with us.
No, no, no.
Not
no,
with
no.
you, Sony.
No, 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 no.
No, Marvel. How do you know this?
Because that's what the whole thing was about. As far as the definitive information today, there will be more Spider-Man movies. This is a Sony official press release.
Okay, then I guess he is connected to it.
Yeah,
I was thinking maybe, you know, in a good strange event of things, Marvel said,
no.
Guess what? We actually have him. He doesn't.
That unfortunately is wishful thinking.
Yeah, he's tied in.
They didn't want Tom Holland. They wanted this kid, Asia Butterfly. The last thing I've seen him on is his Netflix series, Sex Education. I like the kid in that. I don't see him as a...
Did he have more of an Asian look to him, like an Asian-American look?
No, he's a British. He's a British Caucasian guy. His name is just Asia.
Well, it turned out that Holland was a miracle then, I guess. You know,
no, Holland was a gem. Holland is a definitely, he's a tough Spider-Man.
He plays that naive, young, him. He's good, yeah, and he's strong when he needs to be.
Yeah, he's got the youth and everything.
Yeah, I like him a lot. Well, anyway, you know, we know that the 50-50 co-financing Marvel's trying to get doesn't look like it's going to happen, obviously.
And it's like... 50, you already have all the merchandising. You want 50?
I know, and that's what I was saying a few minutes ago. Nobody talks about that aspect of the whole story. Marvel's really being greedy a little bit. It's like the big guy got a splash of cold water, and he's pissed off now.
And he deserved that splash of cold water. Take the
5%. A little bit of reality, huh?
Yeah, because for me, the Spider-Man movies are just marketing tools for all the merchandise. And Marvel's going to make a boatload of money off the merchandising, like... Why do you want more?
Because
I get it. It's greed.
Well, you know, what I notice about business myself, and I'm on a much, much, obviously, smaller scale, a lot of times, I remember, like, back in the past when we had, like, some banner days of business going on at the beginning of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and what I noticed was, if you're grossing more money in the business, and let's say those guys are grossing buku big dollars, that you can actually do more, and you can actually take more chances. You've got more leverage. The money gives you more leverage.
Yeah, absolutely. Whereas, without a doubt.
So... Even if you're not doing things perfectly, the money still covers your butt and everything.
Mm-hmm.
So they do got a lot going on. They got a lot actually going out. That the reason why I think the big corporations, even though we think they're so filthy rich, they've got so much going out, financially speaking.
Yeah.
Like, they're nut every month. It's so mind-boggling that they want every penny they could feasibly get because they don't want any interferences down the line. Like the same way, like, AMC busted Kirkman's back on, you know, on The Walking Dead. They want to have all control. They don't want another guy that's got to get a say in it or makes a comment offline. They want the property, they own it. Hollywood is a very vile thing that we love.
It's accessible.
We love it. It's accessible.
Yeah. So what do we say to fans who are gonna expect to see, like, you know, Tom Holland's Spider-Man showing up in future Marvel movies? Like, what's the therapy for that? Like, what's the...
Well, there's a couple
how
options.
How do we resolve that, you know? Because, like, we're now invested in him being in the MCU, and now he's ripped away. Like, and it's like, think about, there's a lot of plot lines that have to be, like, resolved.
Happy Hogan's a
big part. Like, how do they sew that up?
I don't know. It's going to throw off the next wave, which is the fourth wave of films in the fourth phase here.
On both sides.
Yeah, well, obviously, not Sony, obviously, not as much, because their stuff doesn't really connect to anything.
But their stuff's definitely connected. Iron Man was an integral part of
Spider-Man. No, I'm talking
Spider-Man.
About Sony I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It doesn't affect Sony.
It does affect Sony.
Sony's going to go along and just do what they've been doing Fox did.
They're both
their films
do...
never had a Marvel Universe.
Yeah, they're both... Like, no, Spider-Man was in the Marvel Universe.
Yes, but I'm talking about Sony, dude. You're talking about Marvel still. It doesn't affect them because their films do not reflect anything that Marvel does, except for the character called Spider-Man.
Yeah, but Sony has three films. Iron Man was an integral part of two of the films.
Right, but it does not affect anything on this end. Here's the middle of the line. Marvel does everything they do. Sony only does the Spider-Man universe. So all they do is they write their story based around the Spider-Man universe. Has nothing to do with what Marvel did.
I get that, but they just forget about Tony?
Yeah,
Tony
obviously.
Doesn't exist?
Yeah, obviously. Look, All I can say is that, you know, we're getting heated because we're passionate about this, which is true. We are. The thing is, folks are still going to go see the Sony Spider-Man film because there's a bit of a carryover from the quality of the Marvel films. And if it leads to a Venom type of crossover, the next two films are going to be huge. But then after that, you're probably going to see the quality of their films start to drop because they're not committed the same way Feige can create a great story.
Now, do you think that Sony can make a good Spider-Man movie without Feige?
Yeah, I think so, because there's a little bit of that time when you first leave a situation such as the Feige situation, there's a little bit of a carryover that still goes on, okay. But after a while, it just dissipates where they're going to be muddled down in, like, bad films. Because the Sony film, Venom, wasn't really a great film, but it made almost $1 billion, which tells me that...
Which is crazy to me. And it wasn't a bad film, no, but it just didn't...
It was about middle of the road. Maybe I give it a 6 out of 10 or... You know?
I agree with that 100%.
But, so they're thinking, like, look, we made all that money, and we're able to do what we do without the Marvel connection. Our Spider-Man films could be fairly good because Marvel just made us look good by creating everything they did. The Tom Holland character got better and everything. So we'll see how it goes. And, you know, look, we're going to follow this up because this is a situation we really need to follow up on. Okay, so I think we're going to do it.
Yeah, we definitely have to follow this one up.
All right. Over and out, fans.
Over and out. That was the weigh-in.
Thank you.
On the mark!
As human beings, we tend to be drawn towards doing outrageously dumb things that can put us in a whole lot of pain. And, like, I don't understand why.
I don't know. I think people like to see themselves get in accidents and stuff. I mean, if somebody did a comprehensive study and tried to find out how many more broken shins there are and fractured backbones and people who've got, like, their testicles rearranged from skateboarding on metal bars.
Oh, my God. Yes. Right?
I guarantee you.
Facts.
Right? Well, hey, facts. Without a doubt. On YouTube, there's more accidents. If you can add up the amount of people who chime in, they're all fans. I mean,
and wow. They love that shit. They're like, fucking break your neck, bro.
Yo,
and it's not like Broadway, like, break a leg. They're like, I hope this guy breaks his fucking neck. Like, you want him to be like a fucking quadriplegic? Like, that's not the fucking life.
And if you don't break your neck on the first take, you want you to get back on the roof again, jump off with your sneakers on fire, break the cheap white table at like a Buffalo Bills pregame show or something.
Oh, the Bills Mafia shit. Bills Mafia, shout out. Bro, 716 certified.
Certified?